everybody, and welcome to my 193rd official Let's Play, which is Planetarian for Steam. This is my third ever visual novel, and my very first key story. The week I'm recording this is the week the Planetarian anime is actually going to start. That's some irony. Anyways, get ready for a deep story and heavy feels. I've been warned by many that I will cry during this. I'm going in blind and have no idea what awaits me, so who knows what will happen. With that being said, let's begin. A tale told by Key. Why don't you come to the planetarium? The beautiful twinkling of eternity that will never fade no matter what. All the stars in the sky are waiting for you.
Planetarium wa ikaga desho? どんな時も決して消えることのない美しい無休のきらめき満天の星々が皆様をお待ちしています。プラネタリウムはいかがでしょう?
Planetarian, the reverie of a little planet. I'll tell you one thing I know, I love the music so far. About 10,000 days later. What is that?
Omedetou gozaimasu!
Both my eyes were shut through with light. I tore the night vision goggles off my face before they burned out my retinas. For several seconds, I wasn't able to do anything at all. However, the sound that assailed me next was neither the crack of machine gun fire, nor was it the hiss of nerve gas. No, it was a young woman's voice, clear and sweet, completely out of place in the midst of the godforsaken rubble. Since it was reverberating off the high ceiling, it was difficult to ascertain its point of origin. I pointed my grenade launcher forward, alarmed. Even though I let the tension in my trigger finger drain away, I kept the weapon pointed straight ahead. After all, sometimes intimidation alone was enough. However, if that other person was trying to kill me... The owner of that voice immediately fell silent. When...
申し訳ありません!本当に申し訳ありません!
She started apologizing with an incredible burst of energy. I really had no idea what she was talking about. Waves of bewilderment swirled through my head. Why was there a human being in a place like this? And why a young woman at that? Was this a trap laid by another junker? But if that was the case, why was I still alive? On top of that, why was this girl not quitting her chattering?
実は今お伝えした数字も不正確なものなんです。先頃、
小さな男の子と小さな女の子の二人連れのお客様がいらっしゃったとき、入館料のお持ち合わせがないということで、特例として無料で入館していただいたんです。
Well, this girl sounds like a sweetheart.
ですから本当は、お客様はちょうど2497,290番目のお客様なんです。重ね重ね申し訳ありません。
The figure of a person began to appear out of the light as the persistent after images oozed away. It seemed like a short, young woman. I took a close look at her as I continued to cautiously point the barrel of my gun towards her. She looked to be maybe 15 or 16 years old.Long, lightly colored hair, divided on both sides into ponytails. Strange earrings that almost totally conceal their ears. A hat sitting lightly on her head. Hair ornaments as wide as cargo bands. A short skirt that ended just above her knees. She was holding something in her arms, too.I couldn't imagine that it was a weapon, but its use as anything else was a complete mystery to me. This was simply an impossible scene. Her posture was more rigid and upright than even that of a toy soldier. The ceaseless chatter came to an end at last. She cocked her head slightly.There was a buzzing sound almost like that of a leaf beetle in flight along with her movement. Her long, unruly hair that was parted down the center suddenly billowed out even in the total absence of a breeze. It was almost as if her body was suspended in a sea of weightless silk threads. And at last, I understood. I understood what a defenseless little girl was doing in these uninhabited ruins.Uninhabited ruins. This being who stood smiling like a fool before a man pointing a 40mm high explosive grenade launcher at her was... a robot?
Robot.
Hi, robot desu.
She responded in delight.
Doukan Daisetsuin no Hoshino Yumemi to moushimasu.
With a childish smile, she presented that thing she was holding in her hands to me.
なんだそれは?
What the hell is that?
花束です。ご来館の記念にどうぞお受け取りください。
I looked at it once again. Fluorescent bulbs, old-style microphones, power cords, camera lenses, pieces of copper wire,Fragments of organic plastic. The vagriated bundle of junk was wrapped in a roll of opaque film with ribbon cable tied in a bow at the bottom. I somehow got the impression that this situation was hopeless. Of course, I had never seen a bouquet of real flowers in my life. But it wasn't as if the obvious fact was lost on me.Those were absolutely not real flowers. They weren't even, for that matter, artificial flowers.
ご来館の記念にどうぞお受け取りください。
She repeated those same words over again. Her smile seemed to carry no malice whatsoever.As a result, I accepted her so-called bouquet. After I confirmed that there were no explosives or unusual artifacts in it, I threw it onto the floor.
申し訳ありません!
Well, that was kind of rude.
実
実を申しますと、本物のお花が用意できなかったんです。
Oh, that's okay, Yumemi.
本物のお花?
Real flowers?
はい、お花は当デパート1階の青果売り場でお求めになれます。ご来店いただかなくても、お電話1本で迅速丁寧に配達いたします。でもこの頃、売り場まで電話が通じないんです。ですから自分で作ってみたんですが、恥を忍んで申しますと、私は綺麗な花束というものが正確には理解できないんです。本当に申し訳ありません。
I had some knowledge about robots. Before the outbreak of the Great War, they comprised one of prime export industries in the country that had once existed here. They were so exquisitely built that they could not be told apart from human beings with just a single glance. They thought of nothing but serving humans, and labored for the good of all mankind.Even so, there was something very odd about the way that this thing standing before my eyes was trying to appease me.
壊れているのか?
Are you broken?
はい、少しだけ壊れています。
She answered as if it were a matter of fact.
現在、自己診断プログラムに未知のバグが存在します。バックアップ用電池が消耗しているので、交換が必要です。サポートセンターとの通信が確立できません。メンテナンスコールを送信していますが、受講されません。パーソナルデータバックアップアーカイブに接続できません。頸椎部動力ユニットが摩耗しているので、交換が必要です。
She reeled off her defects with more pride than an old man grown utterly tired of life.
それから、対人情報データベースと会話ルーチンに基地のバグが存在します。そのため、時間経過を考慮せず冗長な会話を繰り返してしまうのが機体固有の仕様なんです。でも、艦長さんとスタッフの皆さんがこのままが可愛いよと言ってくださって、自動アップデート機能を物理メディアのみ有効にしてあるんです。
At this point, I had already abandoned all hope of comprehending what she was saying. I looked around inside the rooms as I shouldered my grenade launcher. A dusky hemisphere-shaped roof dome.As I looked closely, I saw that there were uniform lines engraved over the entire surface. There didn't seem to be a single white installed anywhere. A large circular platform about 20 min diameter. Many plane chairs were closely packed in a radial configuration on that platform.Every single one faced the center of the room and was slightly reclined, such that an occupant could look up comfortably. There were three doors, each one with a green rectangular guidance light shining above it. I had no idea how this could be, but it meant that there was a private power generator on the premises, and that it was still operational.Judging from the cool dryness of the air, it appeared that the air conditioning was functional as well. There was a mechanism like none I had seen before at the center of the group of chairs. If I were to allow my imagination to run wild, I could very easily think that it was a gigantic double-headed black ant. Two spherical masses, each with the countless holes, were mounted like dumbbell weights on either side of a central shaft. The shaft tilted diagonally, supported by a steel scaffolding. The entire contraption stood in a delicate balance like that of a gyroscope. two lights concealed by bowl-like covers, one on either side of the supports, were illuminating the entirety of the room. They were emitting a frail, harmless, orange-colored light. Well, harmless only when it was not suddenly being shown into the eyes of someone wearing night vision goggles. The top of the ant's head came to about twice the height of a man. Had all the chairs been populated with people, it would seem almost as if those people were worshipping the ant. I had only seen something like this once before in my life. It was in a place far colder than this, in a village that a few survivors of the final massacre had established just inside the perimeter of the third line. The inhabitants of that village had fashioned a strange cylindrical idol out of wreckage of battle mechs and placed it in a church with a shattered roof. They named it after a summer flower that had disappeared from this earth long, long ago. They danced in circles around that idol, praying to it in words I could not understand. They truly believed that if they did so, they could get the rain to stop falling. And my mouth's getting a little stuck, sorry about that.
お客様? 改めてよろしいですか?
I came to as soon as I heard her voice. She continued to be totally unconcerned about the fact that a grenade launcher had just been leveled at her. God, that's a long time.
ようこそ 花火師デパート本店 屋上プラネタリウム館へ.
She bowed deeply as she said this. You baby, you're so cute. Achievement unlocked, the robot's bouquet. Thank you, Steam. This was a sarcophagus city. A dead zone, abandoned by its inhabitants after it was devastated by a bombardment of biochemical warheads filled with long half-life payloads during the early stages of the war. It was said that the direct causes of the war were global overpopulation and the failure of the space colonization project, combined with the total depletion of natural resources. Not that it mattered any longer. The Earth overflowed with foolish and selfish human beings back then, and the biggest fools among them pressed the buttons that caused the orbital satellites to fire their germ bomb warheads. Their intent was probably to lie in wait until the bombardment was over, and then to quietly seize control of everything afterwards. However, not a single person came back to re-inhabit these cities. All the inhabitants of the towns surrounding the germ bomb cities had been vaporized in thermonuclear warhead strikes. 1 year after the outbreak of the war, Earth's human population had been cut in half. That number was halved again by the end of the second year, and halved again and again every following year. After the 10th year had passed, the countries that had begun the war no longer existed. But even then, the war did not end. People worked so hard to slaughter each other that even then there was no humans left to fight. They continued to airdrop autonomous battle mechs, collectively known as warmongers, in order to continue to bloodshed. Because the point of the war was no longer the conquest of land. It had become nothing other than the internecine creed of revenge and massacre. The world had become empty indeed, and people who had the leisure to do such things as count the population vanished from the face of the earth. The purpose of life became merely to live, and so man began to produce nothing other than man. That situation dragged on for 20 long years. It was then when the rain began to fall. The rain continued to fall without regard for day or night, snatching away even the sunlight from this world and obliterating the seasons. It poisoned the soil and the water, withered the plants, cracked concrete, and turned steel into rusty garbage. Even the act of man giving birth to man would now come to naught, or so it seemed. There was nothing left in this world but dirt, immersed in poison and unspeakable ruin. For a junker like me, a sarcophagus city was a mountain of treasure. Now, 30 years after the outbreak of the war, the artificial bacteria for which vaccines were never developed had all but died off. Even the vast sarcophagus dung that once enveloped the entirety of the city had been eroded away by the rain. However, the fact that people continued to avoid this area had not changed. When the inhabitants were ordered to evacuate, they left behind all their possessions and equipment, all the way down to their pins and needles. Thus, one could find MREs, various medicines, fuel, batteries, precision tools, weapons and ammunition, and all sorts of arcane devices in a more or less preserved state that could no longer be obtained these days in the unused air raid shelters and the destroyed military installations. And when one was very lucky indeed, one could find cases of pre-war distilled liquor and cigarettes. However, if you let your guard down for even a second, you'd quickly pay for trespassing many times over. This was guaranteed by the warmonger patrols. Anonymous hedgehog hunter-killer tanks and light, anti-personnel, messager drones, all of them still in extermination mode, as well as the proximity mines that could be triggered even by opening doors. Not to mention the unstable floors and scaffoldings that could crumble just by stepping on them, the uncharacterizable fevers that seemed to arise from an infection with mutant bacteria, the hordes of hungry rats and other junkers who might be better armed. The list went on and on.
封印都市にだけは近づくもんじゃない。
The only way to do better is to plunder a sarcophagus city. I remembered an older junker telling me that once. That junker and I partnered up some time ago, and we worked together for about a year. My partner, whose chatter was annoying, but skill as a junker couldn't be doubted, served the role of the scout, and I the role of the enforcer. As we shared a drink of pre-war J&B that we had discovered together one day, my partner informed me about the existence of a few sarcophagus cities located along an unplundered strip of the East Coast. He told me about the abundant riches and untold dangers that lay therein.
だがな、 封印都市で一番厄介なのは ロボットに会っちまった時だ。
But you know, the most irritating thing in that sarcophagus city had to be the time when I met that robot. I pressed for more details, but my partner said nothing more on the matter. Instead, he repeated himself by saying, "Do not talk to it. It's not a thing that is of this world," with a grimace that further distorted his face, whose nose had already been badly disfigured by some shrapnel from a fragmentation grenade. I think my partner said a few other things, but I couldn't remember what they were anymore. Eventually, that junker got ensnared by an obvious booby trap and died too. His final words were, "A can of sardines from my hometown brings back memories." That's why I buried my erst while partner came along. Let's see, I'm gonna read that again. That's why I buried my erstwhile partner along with a can of the stuff after digging his grave. At the time, I wished that his last words had been a little less desolate and a little more stoic. Even now, I continue to wish that. Alrighty, folks, I think we're going to stop it here for now. We got quite a bit done in part one here. We got introduced to Yumemi, and she's the only girl we're going to see in this whole visual novel. But hey, she's super cute, so that's enough for me. Anyways, folks, stay tuned for Let's Play Planetarian for Steam, Part 2, when we'll continue the story and see what else happens. Anyway, see you then, peoples!